even if this was agreed tonight, A, it might prejudge that review group in the wider consultation, therefore potentially run the risk of legal challenge from elsewhere in the children's centres network across the city, and B, I remain sceptical now about whether this is capable of practical implementation from tonight onwards in terms of the council's specific budget making responsibilities this evening. And therefore my advice now, given the challenge that's been raised, would be that I don't think that this amendment, as stated, is capable of being an influence on tonight's budget proceedings for the reasons stated.
If I may continue, my Lord Mayor, the savings we have produced by training centres have been achieved, but it's not just about savings. And if I can speak to it, I'm happy to give some direction.
Councillor Radford, the advice that we're now being given is that this is not a legal amendment.
Well, so, I think that's very unusual. The advice prior to the meeting says it was, and then during the meeting isn't.
Yeah,
and that does smack of a lack of professionalism to be consistent.
Maybe or maybe not. If the advice being given,
I think it doesn't seem professional to give one set of advice prior to the meeting and different set of advice. But if I may assist,
Hang on just a minute, Councillor Alfred, because I need to make sure that I am fair to all sides in this. So if you could just sit down for a moment, if appropriate, you can speak again. So I just need some advice now. Is this amendment a valid amendment as it stands at the moment?
Lord Mayor, as I explained a minute ago, it is not capable of practical implementation in terms of impacting on the Council's budget decision-making from this evening going forward because of the decision that the Mayor announced earlier in terms of a review group that's going to look at children's centres across the entire city. When we started the meeting, the amendment as drafted could have been capable of practical implementation. It is no longer capable of such, safely and securely.
So, in fact, we cannot debate the amendment because we can't vote on it.
I be helpful, my Lord Mayor? I am happy to waive the amendment and refer it to the working party because I think the Mayor has constructively indicated that. I don't have a problem with that, but I think some of the issues are not unvalid to talk about. And can I just finish on the one point?
One point around the amendment or a one point around the widest point?
The point about the amendment and the whole budget.
If you want to address the issue of the budget, you can do that at the next, when we're now going to move.
I'm quite happy if you want.
I can call you to speak.
Indeed.
In terms of the budget.
I'm quite happy to withdraw the amendment on the basis it's been referred to the working party the Mayor's indicated. Is that helpful?
Right. So that amendment has been withdrawn. So we now move to the main budget. The indications I've had from people to speak are... Sorry. Right, okay. So I'll read the names.
Lord Mayor, it was on the last point before you moved on. I know it's not popular to stand up and defend officers, but we seem to have had the triumvirate this evening. We've had the Greens, we've had the Independents, and now we've had the Liberal Party, who have, in my eyes, behaved quite disgracefully this evening. I'm questioning the professionalism of our officers after they have had to go through this whole process with the Mayor, with the Cabinet and others supporting them, to try and get us into a position where we can keep this City Council stable, never mind trying to help the city. I think it's quite reprehensible, and I think councillors who accuse them of unprofessionalism should take a good look at themselves as well.
Okay. When you talk about the Liberal Party, there are three of us, one of us. Okay.
Right, let's start again. We are now speaking to the budget. I've had indications from, and if your name isn't read out, keep your hand up, and as I write your name down, so I've had indications from Councillor Hunt, Councillor Corbett, Councillor Mumby, Councillor Morrison, Councillor Kushner. Right, so I've now got Councillor O'Byrne, Councillor... Kemp, Councillor Radford, Councillor Gladden, Councillor Simons, and that's it, unless you wave at me during the debate. In that, yes, I know it's put, we've all missed the archers, you don't need to tell me that. So, could I plead with you to be as brief and succinct as possible, Councillor Hont?
Thank you, Lord Mayor. It seemed a long time ago as we meandered through the recesses of the Green Mind. But I wanted to follow up on what Mayor Anderson said, was saying about the staff, and where the staff, our staff, work to protect the most vulnerable people in our city. The work of the council staff in the benefit maximisation team, the Liverpool Citizen Support Scheme, is a testament to our determination that as the city grows, as the city develops, we'll work hard to ensure that nobody's left behind. And those people have our support. Mayor Anderson said it, and we do it. But it's worth reminding council that it's the Lib Dems in coalition with the Tories who have slashed local welfare provision. The funds that we use to support our citizens in crisis, a fund recognised by the CAB nationally as an example for other local authorities to follow. It's efficient, it's effective, it works well for our citizens, but it's the coalition that have withdrawn the funding for that, slashed it in fact, slashed that funding, and we will have to find that money within our budget. It's the same coalition supported by the Lib Dems who brought in the spiteful and pernicious bedroom tax. And in this city, 11,500 households were affected by the bedroom tax. The same coalition is currently turning our job centres, which used to be places of refuge for people seeking work, turning our job centres into benefit policing units, who are charged with making life difficult for decent families out there trying to find work. On these benches over here, we have a Labour administration, a Labour cabinet, and a Labour mayor who know why we're here. We know why we're elected to this council. We know whose side we're on. We're on the side of the people facing difficulties at this time. We don't shrink from the challenges we face. And as the city grows, we're determined to work in partnership, as we've showed on the Show Start centres, as we've showed in libraries, work in partnership to solve those crises and support the most vulnerable. And as the Mayor said, we won't take lectures from all those parties who simply, let's face it comrades, simply wouldn't know where to start. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'm obviously speaking on behalf of the main motion. And also in reference to Appendix 1 in the papers of the Medium Term Financial Plan, which is on page 138 onwards, which clearly shows the best of times and the worst of times for Liverpool. So Liverpool's population is increasing after 50 years of decline. As we know, the combination of Thatcher and the Millicents in the mid-80s saw people and businesses leaving the city in droves. And the Millicents giving Liverpool such a bad name, as Joe's already said, which undermined our great city for many, many years. But then with massive investment from the Labour government and from Europe, we fought back, including winning the capital of culture status, which enabled us to use culture as a cornerstone for our city's economic strategy. And even in these incredibly difficult times, have our own growth strategy for housing, the superport, the universities, the hospitals, tourism, apprenticeships, financial services, including our finance diploma for our young people, the International Festival for Business, which shows that it's coming back again. And we're now in the top five cities recovering best from the recession. So it's been this administration that hasn't just focused on the city centre as an engine for change while ignoring the rest of the city as the previous administration did. And this can be seen by the setting up of the mayoral development zones, which are already making a big difference and have created over 400 jobs in this last quarter alone. Joe's already mentioned about the boot estate. It was this administration who sorted that out and gave Norwich Green the good housing it clearly deserved. And it's this administration that has given the Everton community where I live the new Gracie Market, Project Jennifer, which is the new district centre, with a very large Sainsbury's opening next summer now, with over 500 jobs coming on stream, a fabulous new Notre Dame High School, which includes both a music hub and very shortly a library hub, And further down the road, a beautiful and brand new building for the children of Milstead Special School. And don't forget that we've now got 11 out of the Mayor's 12 new build schools either completed or on site, which is incredibly pleasing. And those schools not only provide quality teaching and learning environments, but hundreds and hundreds of jobs and apprenticeships for Liverpool residents and growth in our supply chains. As the report says in the papers, for the first time our population is increasing and we're experiencing a baby boom. So much so that the DfE is now giving us some capital money to expand our primary schools, which can't respond to demand from families living right next door to the schools in the local communities, but only for schools which are consistently graded by Ofsted as good or outstanding. Do we have many schools like that? Of course we do. Yes, over 82% of our schools, including all our special schools, and all our children's centres bar one are either good or outstanding. And two of the children's centres, I'm sure Steve will put his hand up about this one, have been graded as outstanding three times in a row. And let's not forget our young people who attend our supplementary schools. I know Jed gave out their certificates, if you remember. And many of those young people, particularly studying subjects like Arabic, Bengali, Mandarin and Polish, many of them actually got A-star grades at GCSE, including 10 A-stars for Arabic alone, which is incredibly difficult to do. So in Liverpool, our education strategy is based on the principle of collaboration. Unlike the Greens, who would actually cut the funding to all our many faith schools, which would mean that they'd close. That's over half of our schools in Liverpool would end up closing under the Greens. Or looking at the Lib Dem and Tory coalition, who fragment and divide our schools at every turn. So what have we done in Liverpool? We set up a Liverpool Schools Partnership and School Improvement Liverpool, a private company, to strengthen, challenge and support our family of schools for the benefit of all our children in Liverpool. And it's actually working. So the best of times, yes, but also the worst of times. Who would have thought that we'd ever say that last year 21,500 Liverpool residents were fed by food banks? Or that three quarters of our 19,650 requests for our citizen support scheme would be for urgent help for living expenses, for food, for clothing and for fuel costs? And who would have predicted that over half of our children in poverty are now from families in paid work, or that we would be seeing more and more children now being admitted to hospital for malnutrition? Or predicted that the government would cut the 10 richest local authorities by an average of £48 per household, but cut the 10 poorest by an average of £782 per household? So the best of times and the worst of times. But as a city, we pull together, we link arms, as we saw on Saturday, with babies and families joining hands around the Cunard. And Lord Mayor, we will continue to fight to keep hope alive in our great city through these very difficult times. I support the main motion.
Lord Mayor, it seems appropriate at the budget meeting that as a cabinet member I'd like to give some account of the progress we're making in realising the objectives we set ourselves a year ago. So I want to talk about some of the main challenges that we faced in my portfolio and also talk more broadly about the kind of efforts the councils generally have been making to address the challenge facing us. The first part that I want to repeat, which is I want to refer to, is an aspect of the budget which I think most of us are proud of, the Mayoral Neighbourhood Fund. We're going to continue funding that. That's a fund that's been absolutely essential in addressing the challenges that are facing and in supporting the most vulnerable. If I thought it was brave to propose a council tax increase of 6%, I thought it was even more brave for the Green Councillor for Greenbank to vote to axe most of the Mayoral Neighbourhood Fund, which in his own ward funds subsidised compost bins, extra street cleaning, clean up after students, free books for children under five, seven community gardens, support for residents groups and the police. As they say, that's a very brave decision to make, not a very clever one. What's extraordinary as well, just to refer back to this issue, that we're addressing all sorts of threats to the most vulnerable groups in the society, in our city. and we tend to support them through the Mayoral Neighbourhood Fund and the Mayoral Fund, food banks. So the Green Party wants to slash support for food banks in the city. You really couldn't make it up, but you could believe it when you look at the savings we've tried to make in the environmental budget. Not easy. Three of the areas we looked for savings would be, firstly, in cutting the cost of replacement bins by introducing a charge for purple bins, which has upset, I believe, some green councillors. Secondly, we moved to manage weekly collections. In Labour-led Liverpool, recycling has now increased by 5%. In Green-led Brighton, it's gone down by 5%. So it's no surprise that the one party in the city that didn't support the move to manage weekly collections was the Green Party. The third area that we try to save money is by addressing the large number of sites around the city, which actually cost us up to £3 million to maintain the green space budget, by coming up with new solutions, community gardens and other initiatives. One of those is the new allotment scheme in my own ward, and you couldn't make it up. The only party that opposed the first new allotments in the city for over 50 years, which will save us money on the green space maintenance budget, were the Greens. Quite extraordinary. Let me talk about the youth service. We delivered the savings we agreed to make in last year's budget of around 50% saving, because as you remember, we agreed to take savings of 50% in non-statutory services and 25% in statutory. And I want to pay tribute to the staff and all the partners who've worked to deliver those savings. We've actually delivered it a year early. How have we done it? In three ways. Firstly, we've made a community transfer of council buildings, which has saved us around £400,000. Secondly, we've reduced the number of staff we've got delivering directly council youth service. It's been very hard. But nobody's been forced to be compulsory redundant, and I think we protected the overall service. That allowed us to reduce the cuts to the voluntary sector to 25% at a citywide level. But it's been, I won't say better than that, it's never good to look at these situations, but we've managed to ameliorate that further in different ways, by quite innovative ways of pulling together. At a ward level, we put together consortiums where we not only looked at the pot that we put into the youth service, but also joined other funding. So in Crescenton, for example, South Liverpool Housing put 20,000 into the pot, which is fantastic. Housing Association across the city have done that. And of course, ward councillors in most wards in the city have contributed out of their Mayoral Neighbourhood Fund. So if we'd agreed, amendment agreed earlier, about half the voluntary sector youth organisations in the city would have been forced to close or lose staff, because part of the way that we supplemented the budget is through the Mayoral Neighbourhood Fund. And that's been really important, and I thank all the councillors who've done that. I know it's involved difficult decisions. In many areas, I think it's actually going to lead to an improvement in service, because we've asked hard questions of people. In neighbourhoods, we've had a big staff cut, and I'm very conscious of the effect that's had on our staff. This is the second massive cut they've had. They're about a third or a quarter of what they were when we came in. And the service the staff provide in the new localities team, the new streets team, is something I think all good councils are aware of. They provide us a fantastic service, but they really are at the limits of what they can manage in terms of what they're being asked to do. Finally, if I can talk about the community resource unit budget, which I think is a deeply upsetting issue. We did agree that a year ago, a 50% cut in line with the rest. We face particular challenges. Firstly, my Lord Mayor, we received legal advice, which we agonised about, that we could not vary the funding to organisations. We'd hoped to have a new funding round, which might be a way of addressing that. We couldn't do that. That was why, Blake, as I explained to you, I mean, I hate the thought of what's happened to South Liverpool domestic abuse. I've been an advice worker for much of my life. It's terrible what's happened with the advice services. But in this particular budget area, unlike in the youth service, where there were other savings we could make, because we could make savings on community transfer, we can't do that in this service. It's a straight budget. We can't vary that budget. It's I think what we can do, we would do, but I can't ask
lot to help out that budget is to work, firstly, all our ward councils to support organisations in the ward. I'm already doing that with three different organisations in my own ward where we try to find ways to help them preserve funding. Secondly, I think organisations should be encouraged to approach the mayor who will look for funding it, but to protect the council legally, we can't do it without that. And none of you did oppose that decision at the last year's budget. I mean, not having a go, it's very difficult to keep track of all the decisions we've made and working through the implications. But that's why we're particularly irresponsible to have reduced the Mayoral Neighbourhood Fund or the Mayoral Fund, because that is the shield we use for our citizens. And the job of councillors is to deploy that shield, which I know most of us do. And I would appeal to all colleagues, when we're looking at saving libraries, protecting sports centres or children's centres or valuable services,
Pause for a minute. If somebody is being silly, honestly, it's like being a teacher tonight. The light is there for a guide. I was sort of hoping when you saw the red light, Councillor Mumby, you'd begin to wind up. Whoever is tapping the microphone in an attempt to disrupt everything, I'd be grateful if you didn't. And just leave it to the particular member's conscience that when they see the red light and they're going on and on, they should know better or they should be winding up. But please don't disrupt the meeting. It is a bit disrespectful of the person speaking and of the Lord Mayor. So you're not really doing very well this evening, are you? Let's try again. Come on, let's keep going. We can get through this. Come on. Councillor Mumby, do you want to wind up? Right. Ready, Councillor Morrison.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I would like to start first of all by replying to Councillor Noakes's point, and I will keep my speech very serious because it is, but Councillor Noakes can criticise my behaviour when he sits awake at 8 years old at 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, calling the police to make sure that his mum doesn't get killed by his dad. So don't criticise.
I can tell you about the time that we used to have to sit there and we used to wait for bricks to come through our window.
Right.
So we've all got stories.
Both of you.
Councillor
Morrison, please don't go for the emotive statements.
No,
and don't respond, don't respond either. Stick to speaking to the budget, please, as concisely as you can. Thank you.
First of all, I would like to thank the Mayor and Cabinet Member Steve Mumby for coming and speaking to me during the adjournment that you called before. I'm a bit more reassured in terms of the support that these two charities will be receiving in the near future. But this is the last time I will be speaking at a council meeting. I don't intend to speak in April, so we'll just carry on with the speech that I did arrange for anyway. Yesterday I did receive calls from a number of charities who have had a letter last week, addressed last week, I think it arrived through email, about cuts from the Community Resources Unit, stating that all organisations would receive a 50% cut for the next financial year, which obviously starts in April. I contacted the Basement Advisory Centre, which is a homelessness charity that I visited last year. They received £17,000. That money pays for an outreach worker in Kensington Tube Group working with people with alcohol problems. This year they will receive £8,000, and they told me that this service is just unviable now and I won't be able to continue that support in that area, which obviously is concerning. I spoke to Southfield Domestic Abuse Service and they weren't angry, they weren't, you know, they know exactly the situation that they're in. They're just worried, so they don't know how they're going to be able to cope with this cutting funding in April, of course. But obviously they have volunteers and others that they have to coordinate, and they're worried about the consequences of that that will come later on. I met with Citizens Advice Bureau yesterday in Wakefield, and they're obviously also receiving a 50% cut. They're also concerned. They're worried that people are obviously going to have to wait a lot longer to see advisors, volunteer advisors, the fact that they're going to have to pay expenses from other budgets now, they're going to have to do some more fundraising. And the fact that more and more people are going to see the Citizens Advice Bureau because there's issues such as universal credit, which is being rolled out in the city. And I know the Cabinet Members arranged many briefings for us on this issue because it is a big concern for our residents. But obviously Citizens Advice is the first point of contact for people who are going through these issues. So
My speech was basically to urge the mayor to look into this, but as a, from the private conversation that we've had, that is a reassurance. I wonder whether he might respond later on when he winds up about the citizens' advice as well, about whether there's any future plans of working with them on making sure that they can handle 50% of the funding that they're also receiving. Thank you.
Councillor Kemp.
My Lord Mayor, if no one else is, I'm going to start with an apology to the Chief Executive. I did say at the start of the meeting that I thought he was mad to have given up his football ticket for tonight's match because we'd be finished in good time and he could have got there. And I was wrong and you were right, so congratulations. Someone asked me recently, should they come to a meeting of Liverpool City Council? They were interested in... they're interested in this deal, Mr. Fitzgerald. It was you, sorry, yes, it was you as well. I think we all have to come, you get paid and we do in a different way. But I advised that person not to come to a council meeting because frankly, most of them are run in this way, not by you, Lord Mayor, not by the officers, but by the way that we behave. We have heard today a whole series of accusations, half-truths, distortions and evasions, and those have actually come from all sides of the chamber. Let me start with just two of them. Very grateful for you being concerned about my relationship with the leader of my party. I was actually speaking to his office this afternoon and we were spending the day with him in Liverpool looking at some of the capital projects funded by central government in this city. But the only one, I don't want to look at the past too much, but I do just want to respond to your comments about the private finance initiative. You forgot to tell your colleagues, who thought this was a very good point, that every single one of those private finance initiatives were actually signed off by the Labour government. They had to be, or we couldn't have proceeded with them. You didn't actually tell your colleagues that so many of the funding streams which were available to the council in the period of the last Labour government were conditional upon them accepting PFI initiatives. And you forgot to tell everyone that in actual fact, in the 13 years of the last Labour government, 12 times as much was spent through the private finance initiative than has been done even during the last Tory government. So there are reasons for these things. If you don't understand the wider thing, then we run into difficulties of not learning from history. And it's that particular point that I want to come to now. My Lord Mayor, I know that the Mayor of Liverpool and his Cabinet have had a very difficult job to do. I don't dissent from that. I think that they've done a lot of things right, and in fact, it's a fact. How few things do we actually disagree with in this council chamber? How few things do we vote on? Not because, certainly in my case, I'm scared to take on the Labour Party if necessary, but the fact is that I'm prepared to support you in the circumstances that you're in. But, my Lord Mayor, unless we really believe in the Natalie Bennett School of Economics, or even the John Coyne School of Economics, things have been in a very bad way for a long time in this country, and no one, irrespective of who forms the government after May the 7th, will have a magic wand to solve those problems. We were in deep financial difficulties. As I've told this council before, the Labour government were going to take £8 out of the budget for every 10 that this coalition government has taken out. That's a fact. It was in their medium-term financial review. The Mayor is quite right to say had there been a Labour government, or even as I hoped when Gordon Brown came out into 10 Downing Street, that there would be a Labour Liberal Democrat coalition, because someone needed to form a coalition, given the numbers in the House of Commons, that the effects on Liverpool wouldn't have been so bad. But let no one think that they wouldn't have been bad. Let no one think that there were any easy answers to deal with the massive borrowing, which had accrued for a whole variety of reasons between 2004 and 2010. And it's because I don't think that there is a magic wand available to this council that I think we need to have a very new approach. I'll just briefly mention two of those areas. The first is libraries, and the second is children's services. Libraries, and Children's Services both have fundamentally different challenges than they were facing 5 years ago. Libraries faced the challenge of this with Kindle, the opportunities to use the written word in fundamentally different ways through fundamentally different mediums, and need fundamentally different solutions. And I believe we found a sticking plaster. Well done, I'm glad the libraries are opening, but I don't think we found a fundamental new way forward to deal with them. And the same on children's centres. When I gave an interview on Radio Merseyside, I listened to the man say how circumstances had changed. My argument with him was that we knew that they were changing 3 years ago, and that some of the things we're now looking at through the review he's been setting up should have been reviewed over the last 3 years, not least the fact that far more children get access to preschool education on the 15-hour week rule than did then. So I think that we lack strategy, we lack vision, and we lack direction. Doesn't mean to say that a lot of what has been done isn't good. Doesn't mean to say that if we'd been in control, we wouldn't have had to do many of the same things. It just means that we need to think of a zero-based budgeting to look at every single thing we do, not just to see how much it costs, but to see its effects and to see whether there are fundamentally different ways. My Lord Mayor, that's all I want to say tonight, but I just hope that in future that we will try and be a little bit more honest with each other about where we are, rather than seeing things through the prism of our own political beliefs.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Lord Mayor, I wanted to speak at this point of the meeting to ask us all to think hard about the financial year that's meant to us. We're in the middle of a 3-year budget, and it's the right time to reflect on the tough decisions we've made that have been done in the best interest of with the city in mind. We've worked hard to find answers to the difficult questions, to be innovative, working with our partners to get the best for our communities. And that's why it gives me immense pleasure and pride to look back to another successful year of housing for the city. I could remind you of the success we have in delivering new homes, but I'm sure many of you are already bored with me telling you about how we're not only about to deliver our target, but over how we are going to deliver the major pledge of 500 homes, but in fact are well on our way to exceeding this. Equally, I'm sure many of you are yawning if I mention again that we're already delivered the Mayor's pledge on bringing void properties back into use and are now on our way to delivering the next 2,000 homes. But that success, as important and amazing as it is already yesterday's news. I could talk about our groundbreaking house building partnership with Redrow and Liverpool Mutual Homes, a partnership which will see 1,500 new homes developed in the next 5 years. Or perhaps focus on the work of licensing private landlords. I could remind you how we are now the first city in the country to have a citywide compulsory landlord licensing scheme. I know that the development has been long awaited and needed in this city, for far too many of our neighbourhoods and our residents have been blighted by the scourge of bad landlords. I could point out also all over the city to show the difference this administration, a Labour administration, has made from Anfield to Speak, from Norris Green and Croxton to Riverside. We are delivering on our agenda for housing growth and housing renewal. And colleagues, in recounting many of our impressive successes, I could remind you about how all this has been achieved despite the best efforts of this Tory Lib Dem government to undermine us. The last Lib Dem administration in this city was blessed by a national government which was willing to invest in housing, willing to support local councils through clear housing policy, and a willingness to trust local planning committees to make the right decision. Can you imagine what we would have achieved if we'd had the support of a government like that? Instead, we were cased with the almost complete withdrawal of housing grants and a Secretary of State who is as capricious as he is unreasonable, as the Wells Street's decision so ably demonstrated. And of course, it goes without saying that our housing successes have been built on the backdrop of a terrible Conservative Lib Dem, Conservative Lib Dem cuts, which have been targeted unfairly and unreasonably at Labour cities, whilst constituencies of Osborne and Cameron remain virtually untouched. Cuts which have made with neither conscience or care for the impact on the vulnerable. Cuts As my colleagues have said, like the bedroom tax, which plunged thousands and thousands of vulnerable families into financial and housing crisis. Cuts like the reduction in housing benefit for single persons aged under 35, which has forced many of our most vulnerable into unsuitable, poor quality HMOs, which offer neither security nor support. Or the stringent cuts to benefit, which have left people increasingly vulnerable to the horrors of homelessness. Cuts made at exactly the same time that this government has withdrawn funding to homelessness support services and savaged those charities which filled the gaps in the state safety net. Colleagues, everyone in this chamber knows the biggest threat to sustainable quality housing in this city is not land banking or dodgy developers or even rogue landlords. No, colleagues, it's the biggest threat to sustainable housing in this city is this current current Tory Lib Dem government. But the truth is, no matter how many new homes we build, no matter how many voids we bring back into use, and no matter how many rogue landlords we get rid of, whilst our residents live in fear of unreasonable eviction, whilst there are growing numbers of homeless people sleeping on our streets, then there is still work to be done, and we must do it. And whilst I am proud of our housing achievements, every time I see one of the many vulnerable people which this Tory Lib Dem government has abandoned, I am reminded how far we still have to go. And it's to those people, the vulnerable, the frightened, the homeless, who we must dedicate this budget to. They are worthy of our support, our energy and our commitment. They deserve a better and brighter future. And in the years ahead, the only way that this will be delivered is through a Labour government, a Labour mayor and a Labour council. Thank you.
My Lord Mayor, I always find it a little upsetting when the Labour Party believe they've got a monopoly of wisdom or a monopoly of compassion. But I would say in a positive way, the Liberal Party have been prepared, in our tradition of being a progressive political party, to work with the Labour administration to set a difficult budget. And we have tried to be what I call a constructive opposition, making suggestions to how to make the best of a difficult situation. And I'll do the same again tonight. I hope over the next year we will see, one of the suggestions we'd like the Mayor to take consideration of is if you reduce the threshold for vacants to be taxed at the full rate to 1 month, we would gather another £1 million. And anything that incentivises people moving vacant properties into being occupied has a social benefit, not just an economic one. And we recommend we moved an amendment to that effect last year, which was accepted, and we constructively asked the Mayor to look at it for next year's budget. That £1 million we would like to see put into a Leeds type initiative of an enforcement team to target long-term derelict homes. We believe we can be more ambitious. We can learn from Leeds. They have set up a special team to target enforcement, legal checking, probate law, and like to try and tackle long-term vacants. That would improve our revenue base, but it also would get rid of some of the blights on our streets too. Any of us in terrace properties know one vacant house is the route which arson affects the street, the route crime affects the street. It would give an economic benefit and it should be self-funding. The other suggestion we made at neighbourhoods and we asked the council to look at. At the moment, if you're a local charity or voluntary group, you will probably go to three Liverpool second institutions. You could go to the Liverpool Community Resources Unit within the council. You could probably go to LCBS for grants, and you probably go to the Merseyside Foundation for grants. All of them will ask for virtually the same records, the same application system, and will probably deal with the same sort of grants. And it does strike us that if we want to rationalise less on administration, provide a one-stop resource, we should be discussing at least with one of those organisations about how to deliver a one-stop shop and put more money into delivering services and actually make it easier for charities and smaller groups. And we would recommend, as we did at Neighbours, the member to look at that. We do recommend, and we did pursue it, and we've achieved it. Not only twinning children's centres has a benefit of saving money, we've actually found that having two twin centres with a bigger team delivers a more dynamic service, and Jane is very right to say we are so excited that we've got outstanding Ofsteds now for 3 years running in Tubal and Stonycroft, an example of where we saved a centre and creating a more dynamic team for the benefit of both communities. Certainly we did, during the Libraries Review and the Children's Centre Review, press the council to look at the premises costs, because there was some quite diverse premises costs, and it meant we were able to save money that would be better used. I would certainly endorse all Councillor Mumby's comments about the mayoral fund. This gives local flexibility, it gives elected members a way of investing to save within their communities, and I think, in fairness, officers and the mayor himself has complimented the way we've used it so effectively in Shubrook to also leverage in other monies, as well as helping community groups who would be missed off the horizon. But on the broader issues, one thing that does strike me from my commercial experience is Liverpool still struggles. We have a relatively small private sector for the size of the population city. And I think we do need, and I'm pleased to see some of the progress made in the mayoral development areas, however they're titled, and we have different development zones over the years in the city. We really do need to get sharper at getting private investment. And Liverpool has suffered when the manufacturing industry went out, but we didn't gain as much industry as others have done. Small business parks and alike are a brilliant way of encouraging incubator businesses. And sometimes when I'm on the planning committee, I get very nervous at some of the negative comments about student population made. And I think even the mayor of the last council made the comment. Some of the students who come to the city, stay in the city and actually start businesses and can not only spend money in the city, but actually innovate and give commitment to the city they've joined. And I think we need to redouble our efforts to grow the private sector, and the student population are essential about doing that, particularly with the likes of the biochemistry and the like. We have got a large challenge ahead. We in the Liberal Party will try to be as constructive as possible. We hope the comments, the Maidens Council Chamber, will also repeat in the Echo, where we get a different version of our role. But hey ho, that's life. But we do wish the council well. I'd like to thank all the councillors. I'd like to also particularly thank Anna Byrne, because I think she's actually compromised on some of the difficult legacies. Bear with me, has compromised on some of the difficult legacies of clashes over the HMRI zones, and has meant that some progress can be made. And I'm actually appalled that wasn't accepted by the Secretary of State. Because there was a bit of give and take. It took a lot of political courage to compromise over the Welsh streets, and then to have the Secretary of State undermine that, I think, was actually reprehensible. So I close on that. I wish all members well. We are in a difficult situation. I hope there will be a progressive coalition, not just a Labour government outright, a progressive coalition, and it may mean other parties will come, smaller parties will join in to leave the country in a progressive coalition, and that may mean a bit of compromising, but we've actually shown how it can work here. We've actually had different parties working together, at least within the Liberal group and the Labour group on the council. I hope we see a progressive coalition, because if no party wins outright, what I don't want to see is what happened last time, Conservatives win by default.
Steve always said before that he felt he wanted to give a bit of a talk about a year. I'm not going to take long, Mayor. Well, everybody else is. But I wanted to think, this year's budget has been particularly hard for me, even though it is the second year of a three-year budget, because I think because it's 5 years since we took control, I think it's been particularly difficult looking at the 5 years of what's happened particularly within adult social care. It's not been an easy thing to do over a 5 year period. And I also looked at the fact that I don't think there's a cabinet member or an executive committee member, an executive member that's served 5 years as the lead for adult social care. Certainly over the period that I've been on this council, particularly over the last 20 years, I don't think Flo or Dave Andrews or any of the others actually served 5 years before. So I think it must be actually in need of all the services that I can only provide for anybody. So I just wanted to have a quick look. Joe mentioned some of the things that we've had to do in adult social care, and we looked at the budget that we had in 2010, and obviously, if you could do your sums, you know that we've lost 50 million. But it's also worth noting that we actually had, in that last year of the Lib Dem administration, an £11 million overspend. So they couldn't even manage to keep within a budget that they'd set. So it was a £220 million budget, but with an £11 million overspend. And so by the end of 2017, we've got to reduce that budget to £130 million, which means that overall we'll have lost about £90 million. And that's a massive amount of money, even out of a budget of £220 million. So initially, we immediately embarked upon a transformation project that we thought would make adult social care sustainable into the future. And it was radical, it was massively radical. We closed 9 day centres, some of which were not fit for purpose, and I made no apologies for that, they were not fit for people there. But we retained 3 super hubs, one in the north, one in the south, and central areas of the city. I'm really proud of the changes that we made over that period of time, and we did think that that was going to be sustainable into the future. What we didn't anticipate was that this government was going to continue cutting hardly over a long period of time. So that sadly now, those 3 day centres for learning disabled adults and disabled in the north and the south of the city, and the satellite service from Bridge Chapel is now going to be outsourced, but the north and south is going to close. It's very sad. Thankfully, at this moment in time, the line, which is much loved by all sections of different communities which use it, including our military vets, is safe. But for how long, I just don't know. We've invested capital funding in 3 former care homes, Venmore, Sedgemoor and Granby, and they are, along with the line, the jewel in our crown. They are being funded now by the CCG under the rest of her care fund, so we know that at the moment they are safe, but perhaps if the CCG don't continue to fund, they won't go. Our domiciliary care service was outsourced under the previously Demoset administration and went to the lowest bidders. We are one of the 4 authorities that pay under £11 an hour. That gives me no pleasure to say that. I find that appalling. It's one of the things that I never wanted to have to say to anybody. Sadly, over the last 5 years, we've been unable to afford an uplift to that service. We're currently looking at making changes towards the end of this year on the contract, and we are hopeful that we're going to be able to do an uplift for that. So that will make me a lot happier. But there are other things we need to look at within that service, about the training and the support for people who look after the most vulnerable people within our society. I want you to take note of this, Councillor Quinn, because you did mention this about how a Labour government might be fairer or not fairer. Since 2010, we've lost all the grants that the previous Labour government actually gave us, which recognised Liverpool's particular difficulties of deprivation and poor health outcomes. And those included area-based grant, supporting people grant, which Liverpool used to get the second largest in the country, £47 million a year. Mental health grant, carers grant, learning disability support grant, all those went, and they went within the first 2 years. They were what the Labour government gave us to recognise the particular difficulties that Liverpool had. They've all gone. The other day, I think all of us in the city received a very interesting booklet that says, it came from the Department of Health, and it said, care and support is changing for the better. And I thought, oh, something's happening, I don't know about this. And then I went on to read it, and actually, what the government's saying now is actually saying, oh, lots of things are going to be really good for you because your council is going to do it. So actually, what we're going to have to do under the Care Act is add this to all the things that we can no longer afford to do for anybody. And this is just so, it's cruel in a way, because it's actually giving people some ideas that we might be able to apply to things that us as the council are not going to be able to afford to give them. And that's not fair. I'm furious, because people seem to care more about a patchy piece of scrubland called Sefton Meadow than they do about services for the engine. The homeless, the disabled. Where are the banners for them, Councillor Coyne? Where are the banners for the lost, the lonely? I've been angry over the last 3 weeks, angry because the service that I believe in so profoundly is being decimated. Angry for my staff in social care who work so hard and live under so much uncertainty, not knowing will they have a job in the next 2 months, 3 months, 5 months, a year, 2 years, angry with everyone around me. And then I realised that this is what this government do. They specialise in civil war. They set brother against brother and sister against sister. The deserving against the so-called won't play their game. I'm not angry with Joe or Jane. I'm made up that the libraries are being saved and the children's centres. I'm really, really pleased. But I am angry, right down to the centre of my soul, against a government propped up by Nick Clegg and his sad gang of Lib Dem losers who have turned their hearts against the very poorest and weakest in our society and left us with nothing to do our job. And one day soon, even those people who keep banging on about Sefton Meadow will require some form of social care for their parents, themselves, or someone that they love and hold dear. And sadly, there'll be absolutely nothing left.
Seeing the devastation caused right throughout the city has been heartbreaking for each and every one of us. But, you know, Ross's portfolio in particular, you know, it does touch everybody in this room. All of us are aging, some more quickly than others. But the actual services that portfolio provides, I don't think people know the breadth of them. And because they're not out there in your face, and they are those people who come into our surgeries week in, week out. All the things that people have just been saying about food banks, citizens advice bureaus, domestic violence services, you know, hostels for the homeless. Ross has to deal with the high proportion of all of those services. For the adults, for those women who suffer domestic violence, they are an adult who require a service both in health and social care at times, and their children also require services from social services and our own children's services in many different ways. And I think somebody before, I think it was Councillor Ken, spoke about strategy. We have had a strategy. We've had a strategy about trying to fight the government against these cuts in a legal and a balanced way, and trying to do it in a fair way right across our city by maintaining growth, because we need that growth. We need people to live here. We need people to invest here. Otherwise, we won't have a city. And that is as important as defending those frontline services. So I know in my portfolio, virtually all of it, other than a very small percentage of the library service, you know, is a budget that could go. I've fought long and hard to maintain that, because would I want to live in a city that didn't have a cultural offer, that didn't have any leisure provision, that didn't have any libraries? And the strategy we've taken is a joined up approach. We've joined up with community organisations. We've joined up with national organisations. If I just look at sport and the health benefits that sport brings, and we've demonstrated that to our CCG by working with Sport England and the CCG and bringing in professionals to show that just 10 minutes a day, working up to half an hour a day of people becoming physically active, not talking about sport or competition or leisure in a sense of people having to go to a gym, and really working collaboratively with the CCG and getting funding to maintain particularly our sports development. And there's lots of projects that are going to go ahead with that. Sports England going to invest really, really heavily with us. Again, we're a flagship in the UK about how we're approaching our joint working with the CCGs. And I know that's because of how well the Health and Wellbeing Board has seen the greater advantages. There's cuts happening there, but they see they should give money to other services to prevent the demand on that service in the future. We do have a strategy. We don't just have a strategy for the here and now. If we can make our children fit and well, they'll require those services at a much later life. We have some of the poorest health outcomes in this city. It's really, really, and we need to address that. And we need to address it by investing in some of those not just the healthcare, but some of the actual well-being care, because people talk a lot about mental health, but mental health is massive in this city, and people's well-being. A few people have spoken before about capital of culture and the investment that brings. From my experience of being in this role since 2010, what I can say, what capital of culture did for this city is give it its confidence back. We won something, and we won something big, and we've continued to shout about how great we can do things in this city when we work as a partnership across all parties, across the private sector, the public sector, and the third sector, and we're continuing to do that. And our strategy on libraries and our strategy on leisure, we do a massive consultation. And when you talk about scrutiny before, whether it's pre-scrutiny or post-scrutiny, we did listen to what people were saying. We did listen to their ideas, and we've put a lot of them into practice. And it really upsets me when I hear comments in the press or from people who say, oh, well, they must have had the money in the back pocket and they've told us the words and they had that money. If you knew the hours that the officers in this council have put in, the bank holidays they've given up, the Christmases that they've lost with their families because they believe in those services. They've worked there, some of them, all their working lives, and they've dedicated their whole career to that service. And they're the one having to make the recommendations to us about how those cuts have to be made. And they're doing it with respect, and they're doing it with dignity to the colleagues. Again, the job losses that we've had, I've been proud. You know, that I was gutted for every job that goes from this council. I'm a firm believer in public services. I think they were set up for a reason, and I've seen this government just annihilate them. Done worse things than Thatcher, through the back door, telling us other things are better. There's nothing better than good public services that are there within the communities for everybody in this country. I'm a trade unionist and I'm proud of what this Labour administration have done. But I've got to say, the strategies that people are saying we have now, we have had. We've spoken, we've listened, we've known how much money we've got, which is not a lot, and it's getting less, and we know we're going to have to continually review. We've reviewed after review. I did a library review, you know, in my first year. We thought we were going to get over that. We had a strategy, we got more cuts. So I just think people need to, you know, some people do come to the select committee. Some people do listen to what's going on. Some people do read their papers and understand. But I would put the challenge to every councillor, whatever party you're from, if there are services you care about, go and listen, understand, work with them. There's lots of councillors who've come to me with suggestions and we've been able to take them up. I'm really proud that the mayor has really supported the investments on what we've got in this city. We are being spoken about, not just nationally, but internationally, about the great things we are doing as a city. The rest of that world don't know the devastation we're going through, and that's what we need to do. We don't want to have our heads down and feeling sorry for ourselves. As Joe's quite often said, our best days are to come. They really, really are. But we've got to get through this fantastic, and the reason we're finding this small pot of money that we've found in comparison to safety, children's centres, the libraries, I'm sure that we'll find solutions to things around domestic violence. When the money has gone, it's gone. And eventually, those reserves that we have been using, and people keep bringing this up, once they're gone, it's like your savings. You know, how many people now have got savings because of the devastation they're having to live through? They're gone, they're not replaced. People haven't got the income to replace them. We haven't got the income to replace the reserves. So while we're doing it, and we're putting off, and I know Joe all the time, he tells us to go out there and you need to deliver this. We come back and he's going to go and find another solution. We, you know, and that is why it's like day and night. I know all of my cabinet colleagues, you know, the lack of sleep that they've had, the tears that are shed, you know, particularly Ralph and Jane, who are working with vulnerable people, but all of us. And I know the work that's been done on poverty and getting people to leave. People do live in this city in dire poverty. And I'd ask people to read the report that's going to come out and listen to real families in this city, working families, people who've worked all their lives, who won't be able to afford any care, who won't have any services for care, who won't have any pension And that's why we've really got to encourage people to go out and vote. We know a Labour government isn't going to bring us everything overnight, but I think from the cuts that Ros showed before and from our experience, it will be a fairer budget deal that we can build on, and just that little bit extra will help to save so many services.
First of all, to apologise again for losing control in the earlier part of the meeting, hearing a list of things which from Councillor Small, which I know are not true, and I shouldn't have responded by losing control, so apologise to you and the Councillor. I made a note to speak on this substantive motion when I think that Councillor Corbett maintained in actually an excellent speech. There's just one point I'd like to clarify for you, because you mentioned the Green Party approach to faith schools. Okay, I just checked, because I'm sure it wasn't, and indeed it wasn't in the 2010 election manifesto to make any change to fund state funding for faith schools. Just for the benefit of people who don't understand the strange ways of the Green Party making policy, we have this enormous corpus of stuff that's been accumulating over 40 years, which is like the Green Party thinking out loud. And those are our policies, we don't hide them, they're on the website. But they don't form the manifesto. The manifesto is the offer to the election. And it wasn't in the 2010 manifesto, I'd be surprised very much if it was in 2015. But the basic principle of having all state schools funded and not run by educational institutions is actually, I think, a good long-term thing to aim for, because I think they do have a distorting effect on the admissions process. People sometimes go through manoeuvres to make sure they got the chance to get their child into a faith school, and it is unfortunate that that happens. But the faith schools that we do have should be supported. They're part of the partnership, education partnership we have in the city.
Councillor Coyne, sorry to interrupt. Could you stick to the budget rather than deviating down, not necessarily a rabbit hole, but something around education in general?
Well,
and that applies to everybody else coming up as well. There have been various deviations throughout the evening, so to say that 8:10, I'm trying to move things on. Thank you.
Okay, so just to conclude that point very briefly, then, there would be a sensible, ordered transition into this future state. There's no threat, no to any state, any faith schools in Liverpool from this party. And indeed, we support the faith school in our ward. Councillor Jennings has served on the governing body and even done a stint as chair for that. Now, area-based grants, because Councillor Gladden raised this. And it's true, the last Labour government indeed did redistribution, but it did it in a covert way. It didn't make explicit the way that it was moving money from the richer areas to the poorer areas. It looked like nobody was losing, and therefore those funds, area-based grants, etc., were vulnerable to being removed at a stroke. And the government was able to say, in a sense, that the formula it's applying is the same formula right across the country. So this is why we think it's so important that those of you who have influence to make sure you get an explicit commitment from the Labour government to say exactly what it will do, taking it from A and giving it to B. Just mentioning the libraries briefly, why is there still no report on the decision that was taken on the 10th of November that all the libraries will be saved? We're last year's budget, we included the cuts to the libraries. We included the cuts to the libraries in last year's budget, and indeed we debated a remedy for that. certainly in our ward, we're keen to get on with the process of saving Seven Park Library, and we don't have something in paper that will put in front of us about how the friends of the library will get involved with other partners to save that library, because we don't have in front of us a report.
Councillor Coyne, please stick to discussing the budget, not general things around the council.
Right, finally then, Lord Mayor. Although I would say you have given a great deal of indulgence for excursions around. The final point then is just on the substantive question when it comes to the vote. Because the budget doesn't contain the single large step which the council could take and is not taking of going for a referendum on a substantive council tax increase, we will vote against this budget.
Thank you, Councillor Croy. Right, Councillor Jones, right. It is very near the end. Please, forbearance, but please stick succinctly to the budget rather than being tempted to respond to the points that you'd like to make. Councillor Jones.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Yeah, and thank you, Councillor Coyne, because I'd like to get back to the agenda if that's okay. My Lord Mayor, Garst Adventure Playground was founded over 40 years ago by a group of local parents and volunteers. Been embedded in the community ever since. It served in providing a safe, happy and learning environment plus endless job opportunities for thousands of kids and parents from across South Liverpool. As ward councillors for Cressington, the review of the youth and play service hit us very hard. On paper, the cuts was devastating. Many of the voluntary organisations offering youth and play provision for years have relied heavily on local authority grants and survived only on short-term restricted funding. Some may say that this led them to working in isolation and created sometimes an unhealthy competition. Even though South Liverpool had in our place our very own Every Child Matters Forum, working together for the greater good of the entire community sometimes appeared lost. What has followed, however, has shown us that by pulling together, listening and taking advice off the officers, and through careful negotiation, solutions can be found. Voluntary organisations have come together and formed a workable consortium. Financial commitments have been made by South Liverpool Housing, ward councillors from Cressington, Speke Garston and Alison Hunts Cross have supported the consortium through our neighbourhood fund. Together, they've listened to the views of the children and young people across the community. Through shared ideas and with guidance from the council officers, they now have a table, a good offer. Something at which at first glance was unimaginable due to this government's cuts. Even with these cuts, no voluntary youth project has had to close its doors. We'll continue to meet the needs of our children and young people. And my Lord Mayor, every child really does matter in this city. Regardless of the cuts and improving partnerships, we will find innovative solutions. Thank you.
I didn't appreciate that was your maiden speech. Congratulations. And thank you all very much. Councillor Jennings.
Thank you, Mayor. Really, just very impassioned speeches here about the most vulnerable in our society and in our communities. But at the end of the day, the Labour Party could vote to end the austerity agenda. You could tackle the big six energy companies, you could tackle bankers, you could tackle tax evasion, tax avoidance, we could scrap Trident, we could stop the austerity agenda. It's possible, you just don't seem to want to do it. I wanted to pick up on a couple of things that have been said throughout the evening. Firstly, bashing a council 300 miles away for raising parking charges when your own cabinet member said, we're looking at getting money from parking charges. It's a little bit weird. You want to get your message right before you start saying things like that. You didn't actually mention that they are the first council to introduce the living wage, but that's a good thing. Bashing a councillor by name who's not here to defend themselves and really has nothing to do with Liverpool City Council is just bizarre. And personal insults don't move debate on within our city. And I think it's just been a lot of a waste of time of our evening tonight, listening to you, slagging off other people. It's been really strange. In terms of the neighbourhood fund, yes, we love having our ward neighbourhood. It's great handing out pots of cash for people. But what we're saying is if we reduce that and put it back into mainstream funding, we cut out the middleman. If we could apply directly and the money then could be distributed in exactly the same way, people would still benefit from it. We're just saying it should be more direct and more transparent. The perpetuating the lies about the Green Party isn't good for your image either. The Finch Farm, where's it come from that we ever opposed anything about the Finch Farm? And the Welsh Streets thing, again, you said it, but you just keep, it's not good for your image to keep lying about it when people know that you're telling lies. It's crazy. I do apologise. All I'd just like to say is we didn't expect you to accept our budget amendment. What we wanted to say was there was an alternative method. We think that people collectively want to save our services and people collectively would be willing to pay. We've seen how people leading to keep open children's centres have said they'd be willing to contribute to that. If we had a raise in council tax, everybody would benefit from that raise and not just the people who use the children's centres. It's just different distribution and different ways of contributing. At the end, ultimately, a Labour government, if it were to come in, could make the choice to stop this happening. But it's your choice, and you have to make that. And I think your voters would be pleased with you if you said we could reverse some of the damage that's been done. Thank you. Councillor
Pinnock. I'm not able to get angry tonight because part of Lenten observance who recently challenges you from the dip, but tonight actually this is not true. I gave up. Anyway. Never try it. It's interesting because you're confronted by see on side is proof. It's interesting because you're obviously confronted when you give something up, you're confronted by its absence by how many times you stop yourself from doing it. I'm a pretty angry person by all accounts, the number of times I stop myself. I've been angry since I joined a militant job at 20 years of age, straight from university to fight Thatcher. I don't think there has been, I think Thatcher was a shadow compared to what we are experiencing in terms of sophistication of the ideological attack on the public sector that is being carried out by this insidious government, or non-government as I prefer to say. And I think when you give up anger, it is interesting because you've got to use the mechanisms, and when the red mist clears, things become very clear, and I believe that this ideological attack on our great city and other northern cities, particularly ours, and I don't think the achievements of this administration will ever be truly recognised in terms of what it has done, because I don't recognise, I think it recognises itself in many respects. The attack is coming three ways. We know the financial attack. North administration, governing the city with the problems that we have, should have survived a 25% cut, a 30% cut, a 40% cut, let alone a 58% cut. How are we still standing? It's beyond me. I fundamentally believe that in the 13 years that the Tory administration had to hiss in dark rooms, they planned to make Liverpool an example of how you can break the public sector and deliver private sector better. How Cameron and Osborne and Rothbard Pickles are not sitting in this chamber this evening is only down to what I see before me and what I'll tell my grandkids about the exceptional contribution that particular that cabinet has made in regard to defending this city, and certainly anybody else who has shared the privilege of serving this city at this time. It's been a remarkable time. They did it in three ways. The finances we know about. The other one was to implement a number of policies which were so chaotic that it was very difficult for us to even understand, let alone implement them, in order to create chaos amongst the public sector and make private sector more efficient and economic and value for money, and make the public sector look inefficient. And so what we've had is the bizarre, perverse spectacle of when policy is put in front of us and the force to administer it, we have to have guidance on the guidance that they've given us in order to do that. So they disrupt and they create chaos. And the third way is for somehow for the blame to go onto the city itself, onto the administration itself for those cuts. And it's quite, I actually expect, I don't know what anybody else did, I expect them to run the barrage of those kind of masks that, you know, to this evening. It is remarkable that we haven't, and I think it's testimony to the message that we have to manage somehow to get out there, that this isn't about what Radio 40, it's about what the government's doing. It's absolutely fantastic to walk through a clear door that the message is out there. And that's really all I wanted to say. I think it's, I mean, I bleed for, I pray for all of the cabinet and for our decisions, particularly as pointed out here, for us in the portfolio, which is, for me, the one that we should try and protect us most. That's where our most vulnerable people are. But I will go to my grave saying to my grandkids how proud I was to be part of an administration which prevented a Tory administration from taking our great city.
Other members short for not sticking to the budget of the council. So I've given you some leeway in terms of the policy on schools, so please, Trident, I don't think necessarily affects Liverpool City Council budget at this point. I'm trying to be fair.
Yeah, well, I think you're actually missing the point. The reality is that the councillor raised Trident as a way of funding City Council services. I'm trying to rebut that, but with the greatest respect to you, Lord Mayor, you've just done that more eloquently than I can. And then let me move on then to Councillor Kent, because clearly it's not really the court to talk about what needs to think or what matters, the issues and the policies. And Councillor Kent, how wonderful it was to hear you talk about.
We will support the council in a conciliatory way.
Oh, that's bleak. Make a glass eye cry when you want. The reality is, though, let me say to you on strategy of libraries. We've got an e-library service. We've got over 7,000 members on e-libraries,
500,000 downloads have been made, 30,000 titles we've got on e-libraries, and we are looking at how we sustain our libraries for the future. And we're going to be, again, setting up a group of people that is going to look at how we take our libraries forward. Now, what I remember, of course, and you do, that Councillor Kent, in last year's elections, told everybody, and had the petition and posters in the room, that we closed, and we were closing our library. Of course, as well as the fact that we'd also spent £28 million buying the bat office in Queen's Dock. Did you know we owned that? Well, the Council of Kent, we bought that last year, so we've still got that to sell and help. Of course, it's absolutely fabrication. And he stands there and he talked about Nick Clegg coming to, well, it's election time, isn't it? He's going to come and maybe look at the superport down the north end of the city, private sector investments, he's going to claim, look at the growth that's taking place here. What you need to do is take him to the problems that this city really faces. You need to take them into the heart of some of the areas most deprived and the problems that they really have to put up with. And of course, take them to the Welsh streets, but take them to the food banks and look at the problems that we face there, or the cuts and how they're really impacting on our city. And of course, he won't, because he will not want to be seen with you in those particular areas. But I'll try and find out where he's going, and I'll be there. Let me say to my own party, and I'll say it to them, and I'll say it now publicly, yeah, and a message that will go down to Ed Miliband. If a Labour government considers going in coalition with the Lib Dems, and he's at the helm, you can stick my membership card right where the sun don't shine at Miliband. That your party has caused on this city has just been spoken to by Barbara Cummins and by everybody else. And you know, I'll finish just very, very quickly on the devastation and the pain that's been caused to people who've had to implement those cuts. And more, and that's why I was delighted that my group have rallied around Ros Gladden tonight. Because I've been there, and she won't mind me saying, on occasions when she's broke down in tears because of implementing the cuts that she's got no choice other than to do. So you tell Nick Clegg to come and sit in the room with Ros Gladden and listen to her telling about that. We will not take those platitudes that you've just offered Councillor Kemp about working together, because we remember how you refused to be part of the budget making process. We also remember how Councillor Coyne refused to be part of the budget making process because you would make politics out of it and he couldn't make politics out of it. The only two parties that made a contribution to the budget working process and running our city and taking it through, Liberals and ourselves, and we're proud of that. And you know, Martin, you did say this, and I often say it, is that we're never ever given credit for how we've steered our city through the most turbulent financial difficulties it's ever faced. And I remember in this chamber, Tush Militant saying in 2012 how the city would be closed. We're actually punching well and truly in our right weight division because we are a great city, a fantastic city. I'm going to finish one final point, Lord Mayor. Let me make it loud and clear that every single one of our officers in this council are professional and proud to be associated with us and us with them. And I hope the person who made the comments about the Chief Executive's professionalism reflects on what he said and withdraws those comments immediately or within the next 24 hours. Thank you, and I hope you now support the budget motion.
Councillor Ashton Armstrong. Councillor Aspinall. Thank you, Councillor Banks. Councillor Barrington. Councillor Beaumont. Councillor Brennan. Councillor Brown. Councillor Kane. Councillor Calvert.
Four.
Councillor Castles.
Four.
Councillor Clark.
Four.
Councillor Conception.
Four.
Councillor Corbett.
Four.
Councillor Corrigan.
Four.
Councillor Coyne.
Yes.
Councillor Croft.
Four.
Councillor Crowe.
Yes.
Councillor Cummins.
Four.
Councillor Dean.
Four.
Councillor Adele Dowling.
Four.
Councillor Brown Dowling.
Four.
Councillor Foxley.
Four.
Councillor Frankel.
Four.
Councillor Francis.
Four.
Councillor Roygladden.
Four.
Councillor Rosland.
Four.
Councillor Blair.
Four.
Councillor Hanratty.
Four.
Councillor Hanson.
Four.
Councillor Harrison.
Four.
Councillor Herron.
Four.
Councillor Hinnigan.
Four.
Councillor Hirschfield.
Four.
Councillor Hunt.
Four.
Councillor Hughes.
Four.
Councillor Hurley.
Four.
Councillor James. Councillor Jobling.
Four.
Councillor Jones. Councillor Kemp.
Yes.
Councillor Kennedy. Councillor Kent.
Four.
Councillor Knight.
Four.
Councillor Kushner.
Four.
Councillor McCallie.
Four.
Councillor McIntosh.
Four.
Councillor McLinden.
Four.
Councillor Mitchell.
Four.
Councillor Moore.
Four.
Councillor Jake Morrison.
Four.
Councillor Kevin Morrison.
Four.
Councillor Mumby.
Four.
Councillor Murray.
Four.
Councillor Navarro.
Four.
Councillor Nicholas.
Four.
Councillor Noakes.
Four.
Councillor Norris.
Four.
Councillor Anoban.
Four.
Councillor Rachel Oban.
Four.
Councillor Orr.
Four.
Councillor Owen.
Four.
Councillor Prendergast.
Four.
Councillor Prince.
Four.
Councillor Cadia.
Four.
Councillor Radford.
Four.
Councillor Rainey.
Four.
Councillor Rasmussen.
Four.
Councillor Roberts.
Four.
Councillor Robertson Collins.
Four.
Councillor Robinson.
Four.
Councillor Rothery. Councillor Simon.
Four.
Councillor Small.
Four.
Councillor Spurrell.
Four.
Councillor Strickland.
Four.
Councillor Sullivan.
Four.
Councillor Taylor.
Four.
Councillor Thomas.
Four.
Councillor Walker.
Four.
Councillor Walton.
Four.
Councillor Winston.
Four.
Councillor Williams. Councillor Wolfson.
Four.
Councillor Wood.
Four.
Councillor Woodhouse.
Four.
Four. Thank you.
Voting is as follows: for the budget, 75, against 6. To item 7, annual pay policy statement, Mayor Anderson.
Yeah, just to move that in my name, Lord Mayor.
Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Right. Before you all dash off, thank you very much. I had hoped that we would all get out before the archers, but never mind. You obviously just don't like the archers as much as I do. Thank you for your patience and forbearance. If I'm not here on the 8th, it's not because I've taken the huff, because you've all been insulting to me and telling me it's the Lady Mayoress's baby is due on the 8th, and I promised her faithfully if she needs me, I will be there. However, I would like to be here, seeing as it's the last council meeting. I mean, you know, this is great fun, isn't it? You know, to be thank you very much. It has gone on later than anticipated. I think some of us lost it, some of us kept our cool, but at the end of the day, you've stayed to the end, and can I wish you well for the rest of the evening. Thank you very much.